3, 2, 1.
We'd like to welcome you to another edition of Grok Talk, brought to you by New Hampshire's leading conservative blog site, GraniteGrok.com. We are your feared, extremist, right-wing, hard-charging, gun-toting, opinionated, outspoken, rabble-rousing, letter-writing, radio, microphone-stomping, conservatives, and rational libertarians. So get ready for more news and opinion you could only get from GraniteGrok.com.
Grok Talk.
All right, welcome to another edition of Grok Talk, brought to you by GraniteGrok.com and the Coalition of New Hampshire Taxpayers. We are here live almost every Saturday from 9 to 11 a.m. Eastern Time in the lovely CNHT studios in beautiful Concord, New Hampshire, and this week is no exception. We're going to start out with Steve Kenda, who's running for District 24 State Senate, and then later on in the program we are going to have Kevin Kervick in a few quick housekeeping items. Go to GraniteGrok.com, please, and find the free Jerry DeLimas post. You have about a day or two to complete
petition.
Thank you. That's
for
the word.
For his release.
For his release. His hearing is Monday. So
a little habeas corpus required here.
And we've had some great response to that, and I hope that, you know, at least he still has to face trial, but they want to let him go home while he waits. And he could wait for years because, you know, the way the judicial system works these days. And just ask Mark Stein. He's in year 5 waiting to have his trial in D.C. heard.
Against the Neanderthal hockey stick man?
The man-made hockey stick, yes. And then a CNHT picnic. We have a location. We have a date. July 9th. It's a Saturday. It'll be from 12 to 3 p.m. And I don't have the location open, but it is in Manchester this year. You can go to GraniteGrok.com. It's right on the front page underneath the post where we're streaming this program right now. And you can check it out. It's $15. You can order your tickets online, and you can also pay at the door, but space is limited. There will be candidates for governor, candidates for Congress. Richard Gerard is hosting. The featured speaker is James O'Keefe. So take care and go there and get your tickets.
That's going to be a whole bunch of fun, and we're going to have to be there with a desk and record and stream
Mr.
Keefe.
Indoor. Well, it's going to be the low-profile version because we're going to do the show, and then we're going to go there. And we're going to do a real stripped-down version. I'm not dragging a ton of equipment down there. I want to actually hang out, talk to people, and we'll film some of it and do some other things.
You and I need to do a little planning and figure out what a lightweight grok looks like with you and I doing it.
Exactly. So,
unless Skip's coming out of hibernation to mule the equipment.
No. We don't need to mule equipment. I don't want to set up a huge table and have a bunch of garbage. I want to go light. Okay. Then I can actually participate as opposed to just being there behind the table. Anyway, we're here to talk to Steve, who is once again in a primary to run for a state senate seat, District 24, Seacoast. What towns are those? Hang on. I don't have the right microphone on, do I? Try that one.
The 11 Seacoast towns include Newcastle, Rye, Northampton, Hampton, Hampton Falls, Seabrook, Southampton, Newton, Kensington, Greenland, and Streatham.
That's a couple.
Yep, and Mike, just so we get started, Mike, Steve, and please give my regards to Skip. I just want to thank you for having me on this morning.
Sure, no problem.
Skip's still participating, but Skip's got a lot of stuff to do family-wise, so he blogs when he can, and under extreme duress, we can get him down here.
busy guy. So you're running for state senate. Again, obviously, it's a four-person race.
Yes, it should be pretty exciting. I think there's some good people out there. I've seen filings for Dan Innes and Ray Tweedy and Jim Maggiore. I may have mispronounced his last name, Maggiore, but he's a selectman in my town, Northampton. Wishing them all the very best for a happy and healthy primary season.
Okay, great. The I don't live out on the seacoast. I mean, and I don't hear a lot from them except for the Democrats and everybody else from out there because we get a lot of you know, Portsmouth Herald stuff and Seacoast Online stuff, and you get a lot of interesting left-wing perspective. But what is it that is of interest to the people in the District 24? What are they thinking about? What are they? I mean, you've talked to them last time you ran. You'll be talking to them again this time. I don't think a whole heck of a lot has changed.
Well, no, the supporters that were behind me were really looking for a somewhat more conservative voice than was being represented by the then-senator, who's retiring now, Nancy Stiles, who I think has done an excellent job with constituent services. However, given the fact that I received almost 40% of the primary vote last time out, there's clearly a need for someone to express the voice of conservatives. I think what we'll hear from most of the primary candidates will be similar issues around what's going on in the state from an economic perspective. The union leader did a stunning indictment on Maggie's this low unemployment, perceived low unemployment here in New Hampshire. And in the past 12 years of the Democrats running the show, what we've seen is ever-increasing regulations, taxes, fees on an ever-shrinking pie of employers. And not everyone wants to spend their time commuting over the border to find work in Massachusetts.
Even if the taxpayers pay for a train to send them?
Won't happen on my watch. Yeah. So when it comes, what do you need to do? I mean, clearly, when our business taxes are higher than Massachusetts, I mean, that's a starting point. But, and again, I think you'll hear this, we've got to reduce regulations, we've got to reduce business taxes, we've got to make it a more business-friendly environment. And I think you'll hear that from all the candidates. And to a large extent, they're correct. But I think what needs to be expressed out on the seacoast is, well, what's really different about, you know, the candidates? Where do we distinguish ourselves? And again, I can't speak for the particular positions, but people need to know that where, you know, Nancy and I don't necessarily see eye to eye. We may both consider ourselves fiscal conservatives, but on three key issues, Medicaid expansion, Common Core, and I'm sorry, it's skipping me at the moment.
Derailed your commuter train of thought.
No, it did. You took me off the mark there. It'll come to me, but and Planned Parenthood. Excuse me.
Oh,
Planned Parenthood. These are critical issues to conservatives in the Seacoast District, and by all accounts, they're just not being represented adequately. And I don't, again, know where the other candidates stand on those particular issues, but for the people who are either people interested in school choice, people interested in homeschooling, people who are looking for charter schools, another devastating, you know, veto by Maggie just this week. So those are the kind of differences. Now, Nancy and I, we had, there were a couple of other issues where I think there were significant differences. I would say her support for the buffer zone around abortion clinics. I mean, wherever you come down on the pro-life issue, for me, it was a restriction of your First Amendment rights. And I vehemently against the buffer zone around abortion clinics. And she and I didn't see eye to eye on the casino. She was a big supporter of the casino. I like the way things are working right now. I think you're looking at charitable enterprises where you've got local employers with local employees giving to local charities, and the state's getting your revenue out of that. I think that works. I don't think we need a big casino out-of-state money, and it's probably going to upset a couple of people in the
That's an interesting issue, because there are that really is a bipartisan issue in this state. Mm-hmm. Gambling, even when we had a Democrat legislature, they had a really hard time trying to get that through. It's just not something people are interested in, really, and there's not enough Democrats and not enough Republicans who really want to see millennial gaming come in and bring in all their money and all their lobbyists. We've argued against it for a lot of reasons, not against gambling, like you said. If people want to gamble, that's fine. But it shouldn't be state-run. It should be, you know, as you described it. But when you invite, and there's another state, and I just read the article this past week, and I can't remember what state it is, but somebody was talking about, maybe it was New Jersey. Maybe it was Pennsylvania. How the gambling lobbyists were taking control of the legislature. And that was our argument. They've got a lot of money. And we're talking about 400 House reps who get paid $100 a year. And you're talking about, and the state Senate, 24 seats, lots of lobbyists hovering around the Senate because that's the easiest chamber to influence. You bring in millions of dollars behind gambling lobbyists, and they are going to do everything in their power to control that legislature the way they want to.
Exactly.
And that's the risk. Mm-hmm. You know, the Planned Parenthood thing, it's a public sidewalk. Free speech first. I'm with Mark Stein. I'm a free speech absolutist. There is no hate speech. There is no, you have to protect free speech in a federal republic. You have to do it. So, but the gambling thing, I'm waiting. I always, every year, you know, Jim Rubin stopped trying to stop it. And I thought, oh my God, we're going to get gambling, no casino gambling. But, hasn't happened. And you get Democrats against it and Republicans against it.
Yeah, and that didn't mean Jim Rubin was for it. I think he opposed it.
He blocked it. For every single year, Lou D'Alessandro came in with millennial gaming behind him, pushing for a casino, and he pushed back.
Yeah. I don't think it means Jim Rubens now approves of the shenanigans behind gambling. I think he just had other fresh.
He doesn't. We had him on last week, and he explained it.
Yeah. But the thing about the gambling to me is, as you said, the money behind it, the influence, and the fact that it was cronyism. It wasn't, hey, you know what? If you can buy the land and you can build a casino, we'll talk about, that didn't work, Steve.
Is it? Did it die?
Yeah, it died. Anyway, you come in, you buy the land, you bring up, set up the design, you get the permits, and why shouldn't you build a casino? But you come in and you try and get in bed with the state legislature and have it as a state-sanctioned crony capitalist effort where one casino provider gets to come in and the others get to be shut out. That's just plain wrong.
It's monopoly.
You know, I don't gamble. I don't think it's a good thing to do. But, it's about freedom and choice. You want to choose to do stupid things as long as you don't hurt anybody else. Well, that's supposed to be what you're allowed to do. And so...
That's why I think the charitable operation is a fair compromise.
The charitable operation is a good compromise. You know, the way the land that was the racetrack in Salem is now being sold off in pieces for profitable uses from which the state will get money, tax money. There's nothing wrong with any of that. But for the state government to try and steer a preferred casino operator into that site, that's why there was so much pushback. You know, never mind the morality issues of whether you should or shouldn't gamble. The cronyism is the real issue, to my mind.
So, a huge issue, Medicaid expansion. Can they continue to expand it? A lot of cases have been made that the federal government will inevitably stop supplying enough money to support it, and there will be a huge argument not to defund it, and that we will end up with a state income tax. Do you agree with that possible scenario, and what do you think our path moving forward is to address that?
Sure, and I think the Democrat, the state rep from Rye, Tom Sherman, who's going to be running for Nancy's seat as in the state Senate race, is a doctor and a proponent of the Medicaid expansion. My view always comes back to 10th Amendment issues. I don't like, whether it's Common Core or Medicaid expansion, this sending money down to Washington, letting them take their skim off the top, sending it back to us with a whole bunch of strings that are attached to it. I understand that there are people out there that the mindset is, well, it's federal money and we should take our piece of it. But you know what? It goes right back to the reason I'm running. It's about my kid. I want him to get a good education, a quality education. I want to be able to find work up here in New Hampshire. I don't want to burden him with $20 trillion in debt. If everybody in either Washington or at state capitals is all about grabbing as much of our kids' and grandkids' money, It's the anger that either the Trump people or the Sanders people have tapped into. I mean, the reason they've been successful, the group of people that are not protected classes in this country, the hardworking, tax-paying men and women of this country, are tired of seeing their kids and grandkids' futures erode. They're talking about it being the first time the generation coming in not having the same quality of life that we've had. And that, I put it squarely on as baby boomers. We're the ones who've been in power. We're the ones who've been in charge. And we're the ones who've been borrowing from the Treasury to fund programs that it's wonderful to be compassionate, but only if you can afford it. And we've been borrowing for far too long. So my objection is much philosophical and 10th Amendment related. As I say, there should be a lot more in the way of states' rights. What I need is a governor and an attorney general with let's call it intestinal fortitude or testicular development.
Testicular fortitude, yes.
So to go out and actually take a stick and poke it in the Fed's eye and say, we're not going to take it anymore. And what's an answer? I've got some people who are working on that for me right now out on the Seacoast, people who have been involved, disruptors in technology who are examining the costs and the funding, the way we fund our health care in the state and what it actually costs. Given that hospitals and insurers are probably 9 out of the 10 largest employers in the state, putting aside the state government, I think we have the highest per capita number of state employees higher than California, higher than New York. I'm checking on Illinois, but on a per capita basis, for this many state employees is beyond as well. So For a whole host of reasons, I'm running for the seat. Now, that's 95% of the reason you're asking me about Medicaid expansion. I'll give you the other 5% of my motivation for running for the office is that you know how we political types have very thin skins. So it's only when Nancy Stiles' press release came out, I noticed in the press release that she was retiring that both Dan Innes and Ray Tweedy were part of the press release.
Mm-hmm.
Now, wouldn't you think that the people in the party or responsible would think, here's a guy who almost took 40% of the primary last time out. Shouldn't we invite him to the party? And say, well
now they don't invite conservatives to the party. You see, they don't want somebody who actually will disrupt their happy little game.
That's right.
It's an anointing of sorts. These are the people we like. We want to let you know, which actually might be good for you. Because, lately a lot of people, especially people who are most likely to vote for you, have not been happy with the direction of the party in the state.
So I'm hoping if the case is it's the year of the outsider, then you're looking at it.
So. Right. So that's good news. That's good news. Maggie Hassan came out in a press release. Obviously, she's running for the Senate, U.S. Senate, and she will be facing either Jim Rubens or Kelly Ayotte and Aaron Day, because he will run if Rubens does not win. So she came out and pitched a slightly decreased version of the Fight for 15 argument on minimum wage. She came out and said she'd like to see a $12 minimum wage in New Hampshire. And just this week, a major news outlet released a survey of businesses in Washington, D.C., which has something like that already. And they were very specific in the things that happened to them as business owners. They had to cut staff. They had to raise prices. If they said that if it went to $15 an hour, some of them would leave Washington, D.C., or they would have to close. You're a businessman. What's your perspective on this whole minimum wage thing?
There's no question. From every economic study you've ever looked at, is any increase in the minimum wage actually costs jobs. It doesn't help or create jobs. Very few people are looking to make a living wage on the minimum wage. A lot of it is second incomes for the second income earner in a family. What all you do when you increase the minimum wage is wind up costing reducing economic opportunity for a number of people. McDonald's will replace keypad operators with kiosks. You're doing your own checkout orders at a Home Depot or a Walmart. You're going to be doing your own input orders at a McDonald's kiosk, and those people are going to lose jobs. And so you can compromise at $12. I'm not sitting here trying to be critical of Kelly's position. All I'm saying is that any increase in the minimum wage is going to have a negative impact on workers.
Yeah, essentially what a McDonald's will need in the future is a well-armed manager with a technical aptitude and a roving cleaning crew to come around periodically and spruce the places up.
Well, see, the bigger picture is, what are we going to do as automation? I mean, technology is going to continue to improve. Automation is going to continue to come to life. So we're not going to go back and get rid of all ATMs just to bring tellers on board. That transition is taking place, will continue to take place. What you need at the fundamental level is a far superior education system to the one that we have in place today. Putting aside the political bias that goes on from not just elementary and secondary and university level, I mean, almost a given that 90% of the university is stifling diversity, stifling opinion based on what's going on campuses today. They, with centers of safe zones and speech codes, I mean, it's absurd what's happening on campuses today. A fundamental restructuring of education in this country has to take place. Jimmy Carter put in place the Department of Education back in 1979, and every year since then, there's been a decline in the SAT scores, with the exception of 95 when they dumbed down the SAT score because it was making teachers look bad. So that's a $70 billion a year federal program that should be dissolved. I mean, anyone who's not calling for the dissolution of the Federal Department of Energy of Education is
making a huge mistake.
Well, well, the thing about education is that we have state school boards and we have local school boards and we have parents and teachers and all these other people, and the Department of Education doesn't do anything that they can't do cheaper. So that is $74 million a year, $74 billion a year,
right.
That's just being sent down there so that they can decide how to send it back and you have to do the right dance if you want to get your money.
Which includes imposing Common Core. And if anyone who's spent any time on the Internet has looked at either Common Core, I'm not even going to get into the rest of the social indoctrination issues, but just look at the Common Core math to start with.
It's pretty nasty. It's outrageous. How do you feel? Oh, never mind. All right, we're going to take a really short break, 120 seconds. We'll be right back with Steve Kenda. I'm Steve McDonald with Mike Rogers. Stay tuned.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Gerard at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused and interested, riveting radio show heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at gerardatlarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
Need more Grok Talk? Well, you can catch new shows Saturday mornings from 9 to 11 a.m. Eastern Time. Miss a show? Not a problem. Past shows are rebroadcast here daily from 9 to 11 a.m. Monday through Friday. Join us for 2 hours of unapologetic conservatism. And we're not just armed with opinions. All right, it's getting a little crowded in here. Kevin Kervick's a little early. He has joined us. We have Steve Kenda. He's our guest this hour. Mike Rogers is manning the video. And I have Spreaker started a little late, but under control. And
Tony,
who's over there.
Who we're going to encourage to say something sooner or later. He's very savvy politically and is very well aware of the British scene.
Well, we'll fit him in.
And a student of what we're doing, too.
We'll bring him on board here at the end. His segment ends in 20 minutes, and then we'll get a little wild for a couple minutes, and then we'll start talking to Kevin in the next segment about social justice warriors and why he's running as an independent candidate and all his other good things. All right, so Stephen Kenda, District 24, Seacoast, State Senate, four-person primary. I could actually say four-man primary because they're all... Well, we don't really know if they're all men, but they appear to be. Anyway, we don't want to get into that. No, actually, we do. We're going to get into that next segment.
Yeah, how do they identify today?
I don't know. I'm running as a woman this week. So, all right, what a great world we live in. Anyway,
if I ran that way, I'd be arrested.
Do we want to get into education? Or is it just too big of a pie to chew on right now?
I think I share the concern that other parents. I see what my child is about to be exposed to, and he's right now he's only four, so I've been able to insulate him to some degree. But I'm going to be in the position of having to make a choice, and I have the luxury or the privilege or whatever however you want to describe it of being able to provide choices for my son. Mm-hmm. Not every parent does, and right now the way things are shaping up, my son will not be attending public school. Mm-hmm. I do not want him exposed to what Common Core is bringing into the school system.
As a state senator, you would have an opportunity to provide that to everyone. As you said, Governor Hassan just vetoed a bill that was meant to clarify existing statute, which, in our collective opinion at Granite Rock, already gives children choice because of the Croydon school situation,
exactly. Mm-hmm.
Where they were sending a tuition and students mm-hmm. to a different school, which happens all over the state. Schools in New Hampshire send students to schools in other states with taxpayer dollars. They send them to schools in their own towns that are different, that are private, with taxpayer dollars. And yet the State Department of Education, the governor, the education lobby all said, no, you can't do that, da-da-da-da-da.
Her decision to veto that was an awful decision. Her decision to bring Bill Duncan, who was actually suing the state at the time, onto the Board of Education was an awful decision. And as soon as we get a Republican in the corner office and we maintain our positions in the House and the Senate, we will get school choice and we will get rid of Common Core. If I have anything to do with it, we will get rid of Common Core.
I think school choice is a huge start there because I think that if you can only get one of those things, you definitely get school choice, you get the mobility And it allows parents to choose. And then you make sure they understand it and make it as simple as possible for them to do it. Because then when they see what their children are learning, you know, my kids came up through elementary school with everyday math, which was before the precursor to, but it was the next great best thing. And they would come home with their homework, and I would look at it, and you would have this grid and all these things. And I would say, and they would have, like, it would take them 10 minutes to figure out a simple math problem, and I would just go over and go, do this. You're done. Yeah. Do something else. Do the next problem. It was just simpler, same answer. Math you grew up with. Math you grew up with. Math we all grew up with. Worked. It was math that worked. Now they added these extra steps and all these extra tasks. And then how are you comfortable? Who cares if you're comfortable? It's math. You know?
I mean, basically, we grew up with fact-based history, fact-based science, method-based science. Reading and literature as it had evolved, and and math that was done the way it was invented, frankly, and now
you and Newton were doing it the same way.
Yeah, until Einstein and a couple others discovered add-ons, but they were add-ons, But we had these waves of revolutions in thinking, and to my mind, sitting in Britain at the time when some of these came across, they were basically invented in California and worked their way across.
Chicago.
Fads in education, fads in methods of reading and pronunciation that made it harder for the kids to be literate, and fads in mathematics that made it harder for them to get their heads around the numbers and the grand scheme of things. You know, if you read the great mathematicians of the 20th century, one of my favorites being W.W. Sawyer, math is beautiful. Math is something you can get kids excited about. And then they dumb it down and teach it to them in story form where the actual numbers don't matter so much as following the plot line. What kind of mathematics is this?
Education is an institution. It's now become far more bureaucratic, far much too much money invested in the administrative side rather than the actual teaching. The teachers' union is a corrupt, politicized organization. The teachers' union needs to be dissolved. I'm not being critical of teachers. I think there are some very good teachers out there who are deeply concerned about this investment in the Common Core. And even beyond Common Core, if you look at what's available from a technological perspective, how much technology has changed today, if you can actually, the gamification of education, making it so much easier for kids to advance, to learn, to move forward, and yet we struggle and stay in this institution because that's what it's become over time. It needs to be, in some ways, radically reformed. If you can think about tearing it down and starting over, what would parents and teachers do today if they had to start from scratch? And if you get more people to think about starting from scratch, getting rid of that union, creating some competition, that's where
That's basically what the charter schools do, is they've reinvented the methods of teaching. You know, it's still not radically different from what's in the public schools, but they do it with less teachers and more innovation, and they get a better result. Which of the heads of the teachers' unions was it that said, it's never not about the children, don't kid yourself for a minute, it's about the power? Was that
I don't remember,
Shanker?
But it's a union, definitely a union leader.
No, but it was a teacher's union.
It was an actual quote. I'm trying to think who that is.
Was it Shanker?
Look it up.
I thought it was AFL-CIO. No, it wasn't.
No, it was the teacher's union. It's not about the kids. It's about authority. It's about power.
Sure. Yeah.
I just lost my train of thought. We had Jody Underwood on a couple weeks ago with Ian, and they were talking about the Croydon and the bill she just vetoed, which was they were trying to get him to kill it, but they managed to fix it. They didn't think it was fixable, but the House actually fixed it so that we would have choice again. And she talked about a book, and I can't remember the name of it, but it was written by a guy who went overseas and investigated how people in third world countries educated their children. What did they do? Because they had all the choices in the world. They could choose any system they wanted because it was just them, parents. There wasn't any money coming from the government. And I wish I could remember the name of the book. If you look it up on Grok Talk, you'll be able to find it. But they just formed these, like, homeschool groups, basically, like a bunch of parents. And they'd have a group of kids, and the parents would teach the kids. And they'd take turns. And the kids grew up learning everything they needed to know to be a part of their culture and their civilization or whatever they are, their town. And that's the system. That's what we used to do. That was the single schoolhouse who, you know, like Croydon has. Mm-hmm. They have one schoolhouse with a whole bunch of grades. Tony?
A word of warning here, because we've got an issue in Britain at the moment where homeschooling is becoming a serious problem within the Muslim community.
Mm-hmm.
We're finding that schools are being set up secretly,
mm-hmm.
children are being segregated, and they're not being integrated into the British way of life.
Oh, that's a huge problem.
That is a huge problem. I can't believe it's not happening here.
It probably is.
We're aware of some schools, but it's transpiring. There's investigative journalists looking into it, and it's transpiring that there's far more of it going on than we're aware of.
And people are not
tracking the individual children to see what sort of education they're getting. It's all very well going for homeschooling, but we need to maintain the quality.
We do have... That's absolutely
true.
And we
need to keep some control of what's going on within that...
There's a lot of that currently. If you want to homeschool in New Hampshire, for example, you have to report to your local superintendent. You have to give them a curriculum, and then they have to present themselves to a representative of the district mm-hmm. for testing or review so that they understand what they're being taught.
That's a theory in the UK as well, but it's not happening. It's not, and nobody's challenging it. Nobody's following
it. So they're basically setting up.
Actually being controlled.
They're basically setting up madrasas based around.
Absolutely.
Based around the mosques, and nobody's able to keep track of these children. They don't know what they're learning.
And they're not necessarily based around the mosques. They can be set up quite separately from the mosques. If mm-hmm. you have a moderate mosque, you might well have other parents within that area who are still just bypassing the mosque.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's good to know. And that's over. I know Britain's having a whole heck of a lot of trouble with people integrating into the culture and everything.
They're going to vote to get out of the EU, I just read this morning, though, right? There's... 55%
support. More and more life, which is Facebook are really encouraging the youngsters to go out and vote, and they don't really know what the alternatives are.
We just posted today, just to get off track for a second, on that at Granite Rock, and let me find it because it's right here.
Yeah, 55% of the people who are in the current poll are
where is
support
it?
Getting
where
out
is
of
it?
The EU.
Where is it? Where
as much as it? As much as 55. That's actually a good thing. You know, I believe that they are having their suffocating federal bureaucracy moment right now across Europe, mm-hmm. and that Britain is a better place than any other country to get out and make their own way. They have their own country. They have a long established tradition of individual rights and parliament and free speech
and currency.
Now some kind of their own currency.
Right.
Now some of that stuff's been eroded over time. If I was still living in Britain and I was independently wealthy, I would start a Magna Carta society, a bit like the Federalist Society, right? whose goal would be to restore individual rights.
It's funny, you think about the analogy to individual rights here in the state of New Hampshire vis-a-vis the federal government. It's not all that, exactly.
All right, we have 8 minutes left with Steve, so let's get back to him real quick before we go off into Britain again. Opioid crisis, that's the other mm-hmm. banner headline news type story. I'm a Theodore Dalrymple kind of guy when it comes to the opioid crisis. I've read all of his books about heroin addiction and how it's pretty much a marquee media thing, that it's pretty simple to get out of it, that it takes a long time to get addicted to it, but that when it starts, the bureaucracy creates an entire self-serving industry for itself to solve a problem that only gets bigger, because if it doesn't, they go away. I think New Hampshire's on the cusp of that. Obviously, we have people dying. So, I mean, something has to happen. What do you think about what we're doing now, and what would you do different, if anything?
Well, yeah, I feel the same sense of us moving towards the situation where what we're going to be looking for is funding for drug courts and drug treatment facilities. And I think you need to look at the two issues around the origin of the problem and the supply issues. If I'm mistaken, then you check me on this, but my understanding is that 80 to 90% of the current heroin addiction problem here are people who are moving from prescription painkillers to heroin. If, in fact, that's the case, then I'll give you an example. I mean, I went in for an infection. I had an infection in my arm that was spreading, and along with the antibiotics and the intravenous that they needed to give for that, the prescribing physician also gave me a prescription for painkillers. I said, now... I'm not that much in pain. I don't really need a prescription for a painkiller. So took it home. We shredded the painkilling prescription. I don't mean to digress to like the Federal mm-hmm. Reserve printing money for the past 8 years, but it's as though we live in a society that doesn't want to experience or feel any pain. I don't know if you're probably around back in the 89 to 91 period when virtually every bank in New Hampshire was being shut down by the FDIC, and people were losing their homes, jobs. It was a serious economic crisis. But you know what? It was over in 3 years because we took the pain and we dealt with it. Whereas what's going on now, what's gone on since the housing crisis in 08, has all been about pump as much money, throw as much cash out. And, of course, that money gets inequally displaced to different pockets and different corners. And you see that with the relevance to the opioid crisis is start where the source is. If, in fact, it's coming from prescription painkillers, if that's why people, when that prescription gets shut down, if that's what's leading to heroin addiction, then we need to, one, address that problem. My other focus, and that's where Granite Hammer comes in, is the supply issue. And I think I've seen a little bit of the spat between the Sununu camp and the Manchester police, and I'm hoping that that situation is going to change over time and that they'll find a way to work together. Manchester, they've had some success working with the DEA, and I know there's been a bit of a flurry up at the State House about getting some additional funding, but anything that we can do to contain or eliminate the supply side of it. I have a very tough position on the drug supply issue. We found some what I'd call the retail suppliers. I think there's a lot of been arrests in the retail. Mm-hmm. What I want them to start doing is finding the wholesale suppliers and getting rid of them. I
mean, there's it's a very interesting story. I'll tell you what I told everybody else. If you want to read about what happened in Britain, read Romancing Opiates by Theodore Dalrymple. He's got another one out that's more recent that also addresses the same thing, and I can't remember the name off the top of my head, but it's about building the bureaucracy to address the problem that the bureaucracy creates. It creates this circular thing.
Yeah, they call that medical iatrogenesis. Right?
Is that the technical term for it?
Yeah, so the cure creates the cause, or creates the problem, because the more you grow the cure, the more problems you
And
make.
That's the thing.
And that's like everything that government does.
That's what worries me.
As you put a machinery in place to deal with a problem, you now can't have the problem go away, or else you don't justify the machinery. Exactly. So Tony was actually an employee of the machinery, in effect, in Britain. He was a drug guidance counselor employed by private companies. So he can tell you a lot about how the system works in the UK, and probably we can do a little more of that in the second hour, because we don't want to take away from Steve right now.
But it's a tough situation, and my concern is the bureaucracy. Obviously, we have a situation where we have people who are gatewaying from prescription drugs to illegal drugs. Mm-hmm. Drugs are illegal. But we have to just make sure that we don't turn it into this, like gambling, the state monopoly. All right, if you want to help support private organizations who are going to work with people, whether it be through therapy, whether it be detox, which is, as I understand it, about 3 days where you have awful flu-like symptoms, but there's no threat to your life, to help people out, and then help them stay off, which is what Arcanon is for. We have private organizations that already get support that can handle these kinds of things. Just direct these people towards them and help them understand that their life can be so much better than just being in a haze all the time. Once we go down that road where we create that bureaucracy, that's never going to go away. And that's
why mission creep. It'll find somewhere.
Right. So let me just throw something in that general area. One of the things that's noteworthy is that there are split requirements upon doctors. On the one hand, their mandate to treat the symptoms, to minimize the pain, and the customers, the patients, will even get forms asking, was your pain adequately treated? So the doctors, in fear and trembling of not prescribing enough painkiller. And then on the other hand, you get situations like we had in Florida a few years ago, and you get periodically around the country, where the state government or the federal government will go after the pharmacies and the doctors for over-prescribing and creating the problem. Well, damn, on the one hand, we told you to prescribe enough, and on the other hand, we're going to chase you if you prescribe too much. And, the split between the two means quite often the patients aren't treated as well as they could be. The doctors are in fear and trembling of their licenses, and nobody's being allowed to use their own judgment.
Hmm. Well, we're going to have I have a story coming out. The state AG is now going after a major pharmaceutical company whom they claim is misadvertising oxycodone, OxyContin, and they're going to try to sue them. Now, the state AG just sued oil companies for MTBE, which they were required to put in the gasoline, and which the EPA said was safe, and they got $235 million. So now they're going to sue a pharmaceutical company for not because because doctors are too stupid, apparently, to understand what glossy marketing and quick talk is versus the reality of what they know for a drug that's 100 years old and whose effects are well known. So we will have that story coming out pretty soon related to that. But how do people reach you, help support your campaign, donate, whatever you need?
The website is the easiest way to do that, at Kenda4Senate. That's Kenda, the digit 4, Senate.com. You'll have plenty of information out there about how to either get a hold of us. Happy to answer any questions. There's a Kenda4Senate Facebook page. If anybody wants to reach out, comment, and feel free to reach me there as well. Please say thank you, Steve and Mike, for having me this morning.
All right, well, we'll probably have you on again, and hopefully before the primary and hopefully after the primary. All right, Steve, thank you very much. We're going to take a break. Everybody stay tuned. We'll be right back. We'll talk about the Brexit and whatever else happens to...
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Gerard at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused, and interested, riveting radio show heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at GerardAtLarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now at the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
Need more Grok Talk? Well, you can catch new shows Saturday mornings from 9 to 11 a.m. Eastern Time. Miss a show? Not a problem. Past shows are rebroadcast here daily from 9 to 11 a.m. Monday through Friday. Join us for 2 hours of unapologetic conservatism. And we're not just armed with opinions.
I'm going to go find this and see if it plays to start off our next segment. I got to locate it, though. We'll listen to Bob Marley while we wait. I got to go find it. It's around here somewhere. This, go ahead. Sorry.
Good Republican Bob Marley.
Good Republican Bob Marley, yes. I should play this for the Libertarian guests.
Kevin, you like to move over so you're in front of the banner?
Sure. Should I keep this one on? Or
yeah, you can leave that on. That's fine. I don't know if this is going to play because sometimes the way my audio works, it doesn't.
Ow, I'm so sore.
How's the beer house doing?
Not too bad. We just got a little insurance thing today. The insurance company was fighting us on some beer that we froze accidentally because our cooler
broke. I remember, because we had the whole big push thing. All right, let's see if. Let me turn Bob off. Bob, quiet. All right, I don't know if this is going to play, but we'll hope it does. It's not playing. Sometimes it just doesn't. Anyway, it's called The Moment of Truth, and it's a gentleman in Britain who has a blog, a YouTube channel, and he has it. I posted it on the front of graniterock.com. You can see it. Mm. He has this absolutely outstanding 10-minute video talking about how this is a historical turning point for Britain and that people have to go out and get them out of the EU or they will lose all their sovereignty to this European corporate whatever you want to call it.
Communist entity.
And it's an excellent piece, and it won't play for some reason, even though I've got all my audio wired in. So we can talk about the Brexit because we have Brits in the room who are familiar, including somebody who was just there. When did you fly over?
Tuesday.
Still jet lagged. So as of Tuesday, he was on the ground. In Britain. So, you're in favor of the Brexit? Or not?
I think so. I'm not sure how it'll work out because I don't really trust the people who are advocating, quite a few of the people who are advocating Brexit. Mm-hmm. If I felt that we were going to have a true democracy in Britain at the end of it, that would be a different matter. But I kind of have reservations about that.
Okay, that seems pretty fair. I think that. Do you think that you would have any chance at democracy if you stay in the EU?
No. Not much.
Okay. So
it's a choice between none at all and slim, I think, is the is what we're talking about here.
So not a lot of hope. Maybe it'll work out.
We have the same choice. I think
using fear,
presidential
using
here.
Fear and threats to influence people is the wrong way to have the discussion.
Yeah,
that's what we're doing.
Sadly, it's very effective, though. You know, the minute you tie emotion to something, a lot of people are like, which is why we are where we are right now in the United States.
Would you say that the stay side is employing more fear and scare tactics than the
leave? Oh, definitely.
That's what I thought. They're claiming economic collapse, being shunned by the entire world, all the rest of it.
To renegotiate non-existent trade agreements.
Yeah. Obama's over there saying, well, you go to the back of the line for trade agreements if you leave the common market. Please, do we really believe that? So
I'm trying to get this to work. I really wish it would.
Yeah. In the meantime, we got Kevin Kervick with us. And you're running for Senate as well, Kevin?
Just decided. State Senate. District 13, which is Nashua. Yeah.
And who is that going to be unlucky for, Kevin?
Betty Lasky is my opponent.
The sign stealer's wife?
Yes. Elliot, we have a picture of Elliot on Granite Rock.
I don't have any opposition stealing research signs. Yet, so I don't really know.
We do.
Oh, you do? Okay.
We do have some, yes. Elliot violated state law. In theory, he could have lost his right to vote for violating campaign finance, but campaign law.
Okay? That's her husband?
Her husband,
oh,
Elliot,
okay.
Yeah. Of course, nothing got done. The police didn't charge him. The AG didn't investigate or pursue him because he's a protected class of people.
Oh.
He was just doing the people. He was just overwrought with emotion. He just couldn't help himself.
Yeah.
And the photographer couldn't help themselves snapping a picture of him.
I feel sorry for those people.
I know. Anyway, for those of you who don't know who Betty Lasky is, just Google her. Okay. He's a Democrat.
How are you spelling that?
Elliot, E-L. Oh, Elliot Lasky is, actually, Betty Lasky, her last is L-A-S-K-E-Y?
No, just
it's
Y.
Just L-A-S-K-Y.
L-A-S-K-Y.
B-E-T-T-E.
Mm-hmm.
L-A-S-K-Y. She's actually a nice lady, and she's a nice person. It's ideologically where you run into problems, you know, because she supports the expansion of government, what we were talking about, all the money from D.C., it's free money, it's not, you know, all those sorts of things. So
every union in New Hampshire has apparently endorsed her. So
I wouldn't be surprised if they did.
Look at her funding. That's pretty much where it's coming from. So
yeah. So that'll be – is there anybody else running?
No, so far no.
No, just you and her.
So no other Republicans.
Well,
according to Karen,
no
rhino squishes trying to get in front of you.
I've heard that there's actually they have until Wednesday. That's the rumor I heard. They have until Wednesday to actually, since there's no Republican that's come forward, they can actually find somebody. So they still may find somebody. So,
but the filing deadline supposedly passed yesterday. Correct?
Yesterday
it did. But if you don't have a person for the seat, there is an extension that allows the party to find somebody to run for that seat as a Republican or a Democrat if there is no representative of the party available at the time.
Does Kevin not count as said?
He's not running as a Republican. He's running as an independent.
Running as independent.
Oh.
He left the party, remember, last
time
he was
here? I was never
in
the party.
Oh, you were never in the party.
I've always been undeclared, yeah. Run.
Oh, okay.
I become Republican when I...
When you need to run for something.
Or so I need to vote.
There's a young man in Nashua, I got to find out what ward he's in, that wants to run, and he took his father's advice and registered to vote as an independent. He then goes to register to run as a Republican and finds out he's missed the deadline to change back to Republican.
Well, that's what happened to me. Yeah. I would have had to change over last Monday, and I didn't realize that.
I thought I had a couple days. So he's going to run as an independent for state legislature, and I got to introduce you to him because he's a good lad.
And they only need, I think, 50...
He's going to get 150 signatures. This is for the State House by August 10th.
Yeah, I need 750 signatures by August 10th. So it's a pretty big task.
Well, you know what? Maybe you can put your boots on the ground with his boots on the ground.
That's a good idea, actually.
See if you get a few extra signatures between you.
Is he Ward 35?
I'm going to have to find out.
I mean, Ward 8, District 35?
I don't know exactly. Okay. Let's figure it out.
Yeah.
Anyway, it sounds like fun. So running as an independent. So that's why the party may have to mount a challenge to you?
Yeah, I mean,
they have till August 10th to round up the papers to run as a Republican?
No. Republican doesn't need any nomination papers. Yeah, so they're all, once you're in, you're in. So.
Oh, so if there's no primary, they don't need to file.
No.
Because they don't need to file for the primary, they can come up against you late.
Well, no, they would have until Wednesday to put somebody forward.
Oh, okay, that's not so bad.
Worst case, yeah. They can always throw up a write-in.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's always an option. And, you know, I don't know. I don't see Lasky's district as one where you wouldn't want to run. I mean, obviously, there's, like, my district is pretty Republican. Mm. Merrimack, Bedford, goes out to New Ipswich. These are all Republican towns. Yeah. So some years, they don't even run anybody in that district, that state senate district, mm-hmm. because it's just a waste of money. You know, why spend $50,000 on a race you're probably not going to win?
Right.
You know, they would rather spend it in the Bedford against Andy Sanborn, where he wins, squeaky wins every single year against the same guy
right.
who's running again. I can't remember his name. But, you know, it doesn't make sense to them. They can't win the seat. Why don't you win a seat you can win? Mm-hmm. So,
the Republican Party puts somebody up against Andy every year?
No. The Democrat Party puts somebody against Andy every year. The Democrats don't put somebody up against my state senator.
Oh, got it. Okay. Yeah.
Because my district is plus whatever, too hard to win.
Yeah.
So, it may not always be that way, but, you know, and the town of New Hampshire has had two Democrats. We have 8 state reps in the state house. We have had 2. In the last 10 years, each served one term. It's almost always all Republicans. Now, granted, this year, some of those Republicans went into leadership and behaved like Democrats. Some of those people we can't get rid of because they're just too well-known in town, and people will just vote for them because of the name.
I venture to say I'm far more conservative than a number of the so-called Republicans that are running or that are in the House. They're in the Senate already, so... I wanted to run as an independent because I don't want to be beholden to the party. I don't want to support Donald Trump. And I felt like if I got into that position, the pressure is going to be put on me to get behind the Republican candidate. And I just don't think I can do that in good conscience. But I spoke to somebody in the know, a friend of ours, and he encouraged me to run as a Republican and didn't think that would be an issue necessarily. So that's why I was going to go forward and register as a Republican and run as a Republican, but then I realized I had missed a deadline. So I thought, well, maybe this is sort of providence anyway. I really wanted to run as an independent and be independent, and so that's what I decided to do.
I don't think there's any harm in that whatsoever, and I think it'll work out for you. Well, you've got some name recognition. You've got the well thought out positions. You're going to make sure you show up at the Nashua Republicans as well?
They're encouraging me to do that, yeah.
Please do. They're a good bunch.
Yeah. Karen Karen Toman. She wants to work and help my campaign. And I've been speaking with Beth Scare. She may want to get involved as well.
That's good.
The Twombleys, you know.
Yeah, I'll be the only pro-life candidate running in this district, District 13. So that says something, so...
It's an unusual thing. Yeah. Fundraising?
Well, we'll see what happens.
Yeah, that's going to be tough. State Senate races are far more expensive than they should be. If nobody else is running, though, and you don't have a primary or anything like that,
helps. I'm going to focus on getting my signatures for the first 2 months, getting my message out, and we'll see how it goes. If I get the signatures and my message is out, then we're in a whole new ball game after August. So I'll have between August 15th and November.
You will get a little traction as an independent because this is kind of that sort of year. Yeah. And 30% of the state, over 30% of the state is technically independent, even though a lot of those people are Republicans or Democrats who are registered as independents.
Right.
Some of them just so they can vote in either primary, and some because they just aren't quite left or right enough to really, I mean, I don't know why they couldn't possibly be too centrist to be part of the HGOP, let's be honest.
Yeah.
You know, that's about as centrist as you can get on the right.
Right.
But yeah, fundraising is always a problem. I know people, maybe you don't need to. Maybe, I mean, if you can get, like you said, if you can get, you know, get on TV, you know, get some radio time, find a way to get in the paper.
Well, that's the key. I do a blog and patch. I've got my own little local access show. If there's no one else running, I'll have a chance, I would assume, to get in the National Telegraph and to be involved in some discussions and some media. So it should be some free media I can get. So I feel like there's some opportunities for me to get my message out there.
It would be pretty impressive if you did well, even if you didn't win, if you did well on a very low budget, because that's unusual. We've had people spend over $100,000 to run for a state Senate seat for a job that pays $100 a year.
Jeez, unbelievable. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Well, that's really serving the public or being bought and paid for. Take your pick.
Yeah, depending on who donates to you.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the narrative.
Yeah.
You know, one of the benefits of running as an independent was on very clear display at the State House this week. I attended a couple of filings, and the thing that was most evident was that the media, whether they claim to be Democrats or not, are going to ask every Republican candidate, so have you now or will you ever support the outrageous statements of Donald Trump?
Yeah, I mean,
and, you know, they're trying to Todd Akin everybody.
And obviously the answer is,
I'm going to support the party's nominee. I may not necessarily support all of his statements. You know, don't bother to ask me that again. You're going to get the same answer.
Yeah. No, I'd be like, well, let's be honest. This is a person who has associations with La Raza, which he shouldn't as a judge. He should be completely impartial. He shouldn't have any association with a group who is pretty much sworn to be against this particular person. And now you're a judge in that case. A similar problem came up when Barack Obama endorsed Hillary Clinton. Barack Obama is the boss of the top cop of the nation who runs the FBI, who is investigating Hillary Clinton. So now he has a conflict of interest because the FBI is investigating Hillary Clinton.
Right.
Okay? She's under investigation for crimes.
A federal investigation.
Federal crimes.
Right.
All right? Treason is a possible, based on the things that are tied to this investigation. 127 agents. That case cannot go forward without President Obama going, bing. Okay?
Yeah, because his puppet, Loretta Lynch, is the one that has to approve the prosecution.
Right, and he's the top cop, and if he says no, so, you know, and this was, Mark Stein was talking about this yesterday or the day before, the Supreme Court just ruled that in a death row case in Pennsylvania, 35-year-old death row case, the current head of the state Supreme Court in Pennsylvania was the prosecuting attorney that put this guy in prison.
Right.
They said that he has to recuse himself. He cannot, as the prosecuting attorney, also be the judge. Same situation. Obama cannot. He's already, I mean, now the whole system's corrupted.
Totally corrupted.
So, yeah. And well, he didn't need to nominate her. She's not even in the nominee yet.
Yeah. Trump is right about this issue, I think. And I've said all along, I support Trump, the movement. I support a lot of Trump's positions and issues. I don't support Trump the man, and I don't think he's a conservative. There are many things that I really disagree with him, but I don't believe anything he says.
And he's definitely got authoritarian tendencies.
Authoritarian tendencies.
You know, Benito Trumpolini.
Never mentions liberty. I've never heard him use the word liberty in my life. I mean, he's a top-down guy, you know. He's had how many lawsuits? 3,500 lawsuits he's been. I mean, there's just so many awful things that I just couldn't.
He's authoritarian.
Get behind.
And that is a problem, you know. But I wrote this. Did I write it yesterday? I'm looking for it right now. Here it is. Here's the thing.
Go on.
Okay, this is what I wrote yesterday. I am amused, and I wrote amused because I am amused by many things, by Republicans who say they would rather vote for Hillary because Trump is a bully. Trump can't possibly compete with the sort of bully that Hillary Clinton is, or the bully machine that is the Democrat Party in the United States that defends her. Just for starters, ask the women Bill Clinton has sexually assaulted. They'll tell you a thing or two about what sort of bully Hillary Clinton is. So, you know, people are walking this very strange line where you can jump into a pit of razor blades, Hillary Clinton, right? Because if she's elected president, we know what's going to happen. And then you have Donald Trump. Those are your choices. That's what we got. Unless something happens at the convention that nobody's anticipating, that completely either convention. I mean, what if something happens at the Democrat convention and all of a sudden it becomes, you know, Bernie?
Bernie's people are going after Hillary big time.
I know, yeah, they're not
done. And what happens if the showdown is so bad and Hillary is so precarious that they drop in, or should I say, plug in Uncle
Biden,
Joe?
Plug in Uncle Joe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Rush coined that a few days ago.
Plug in Joe Biden.
Plug in plugs Biden. That's because of his hair transplants.
I'm for a new party. I think the Republican Party, the national level especially, is a disaster. I mean, I'm for a new conservative party.
I absolutely agree. You know, we've tried various ways to take over the state party. As you know, we put in a chairman. They forced him out. We tried to get a very, very good and very unifying vice chairman promoted to chairman. They threatened him with all sorts of sleaze if he put his name in the ring, said, we'll ruin your reputation, we'll call you senile, we'll stop the money flow to the party.
Yeah.
They actually did that to Cliff Hurst. Who would do that to Cliff Hurst?
Yeah.
You know,
the Republicans. Yeah.
So it's big stakes, big game hunting. It's a tough field.
It is indeed big game hunting, and as Pat Toomey said as he took over the Club for Growth a few years back, rhino hunting is always in season.
All right, we are going to take it's the end of this hour. We're going to take a quick, really short break, and then we'll start the beginning of the next segment. We'll come back and talk about battling social justice warriors. Everybody hang in. We'll be right back.
The opinions expressed on this program are those of the speakers and not necessarily those of CNHT, GraniteRock.com, this station, or anyone else for that matter. Some of the content on this program is shared under the fair use provision of U.S. copyright law, found free in the public domain, or covered under Attribution 3.0. Some of the music on this program is provided by Kevin MacLeod at Incompetech.com.
We'd like to welcome you to another edition of Grok Talk, brought to you by New Hampshire's leading conservative blog site, GraniteGrok.com. We are your feared extremist, right-wing, hard-charging, gun-toting, opinionated, outspoken, rabble-rousing, letter-writing, radio, microphone-stomping, conservatives, and rational libertarians. So get ready for more news and opinion you could only get from GraniteGrok.com.
Grok Talk.
All right, I told you it was a short break. I was serious when I said that. Welcome back. I'm Steve McDonald here with Mike Rogers. Tony, I don't know your last name.
Hennigan.
Okay, and
Kevin Kervick,
who is a regular visitor, and we're going to talk about a very common topic that we come up with because it's huge. It is a fiscal issue and a social issue.
Can I announce the number for the flasher?
Yes, you may.
All right.
If you want to call in.
If you would like to call in and participate in the outrageous and frequently off-course discussions here at GraniteGrok.com, the number is 603-715-9689, and it will set off the Lasky flasher over here.
Not Lasky.
Lasky, what was his name?
I can't remember. I always forget. I'll think of it. Don't worry.
Yeah.
Ed Lasky.
Ed Lasky. Yeah. Different Lasky.
Different Lasky altogether.
Yeah.
Anyway, so
I say a lot.
Social justice warriors.
Social justice. So the latest. Have you heard the latest?
I may have. Tell me, and I'll let you know.
Fill us in.
The social justice crusaders are trying to appropriate our Father's Day. Are you father? We're all fathers here. Trying to take away our Father's Day. Because
I actually hadn't heard about that. So please do tell.
It's not fair to people that don't have fathers, and it's mean.
Everybody has a father.
It's a microaggression. Well, they would prefer just the direct sperm insemination method, but they're
still have a father.
Fortunately,
you have a donor.
It
has to be a father.
Yeah, but two corporations are. One last year, I forget the other one this year. They're running a commercial saying Happy Father's Day to the mothers. To the families that, where there are no fathers, and therefore the mother had to be the mother and the father. So they're now saying they're appropriating Father's Day.
Why don't we just make Father's Day Government Day? Thank you, government, for filling in for fathers.
I predict they will eliminate Father's Day within 3 years. That's my prediction, because it's not fair to people that don't have fathers. So you can't have a holiday that's not fair.
And that's 40%. That's 40% of all the children who are born in this country now every year.
Exactly. So
they're born out of wedlock.
All these people that don't have fathers, it's not fair. They feel bad on Father's Day, and it gives them depression. It gives them sadness.
Well, perhaps we should revert to what Mothering Sunday was actually about, because it wasn't Mother's Day. It was Mothering Sunday. And that was a day that people who were in service or working away from home would return to their mother church.
Mm-hmm. Oh, is that right?
To restate their faith.
The real Mother's Day, as founded, is Mid-Lent Sunday.
Hmm.
It is a church holiday, not a Hallmark holiday, as happens in the United States.
Well, we had to secularize it,
Yeah. It in the United States, it's represented by a piece of cardboard. In older cultures, it's actually a religious holiday.
You can't make money off of.
I give my wife sacramental wine. Okay. Does that count? Get blessed, and there you go, honey.
So that's the latest. So we'll eliminate Father's Day for sure. It's mean. It's not nice, But there's actually some victories out there. There's a great organization called FIRE, Foundation for Individual Rights and Education. And they're winning all their cases. I mean, they really, you know, they have a scorecard now where they're rating universities on their free speech. And, you know, it's good to get on that scorecard. They're taking on all kinds of social justice issues, and they're typically winning.
Fire's been around for a while, too.
Yeah, yeah, David French was the head of Fire for a while.
Oh, cool. The one that the Never Trump people wanted to run as their presidential
candidate.
Whom
I would have voted for.
Well, David French, whom we had on the show a couple weeks, about a month ago. So, yeah.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, he was on the show. Yeah. Yeah, he was head of Fire. But Fire's winning all over the country. I'm actually trying to get them involved in my case. I mentioned last time that I had an issue with Montana State University. And this is for all the Second Amendment people out there that want to know about my gun credentials, which I'm sure they'll be asking. I sponsored a group called Students for Concealed Carry at Montana State. And in addition to Students for Common Sense, and that got my dean all lathered up and my colleagues all lathered up. And first they tried to give me some helpful advice about this could affect your career and you might make people a little bit uneasy.
What are the
upset.
Carry rules in Montana, by the way? Do you know?
It's a concealed carry.
If you can find a gun, you can carry it.
Yeah, it's one of the most gun-friendly states in the union.
So why would the university in Big Sky Country be opposed to the background policies and constitutional rights of
because
Big Sky Country?
Because it's a lovely oasis of social justice niceness in Bozeman within... You know, the cradle of social justice.
It's a little safe space.
The safe space.
The safe space.
The safe space.
Is all of Bozo Man a set of bozos or just the university campus?
The campus, what pretty much the whole university is the town. It's a great town, actually. I love the people there. But that got me in big trouble, and then they started a little bit to push a little bit harder, and eventually they didn't renew my teaching contract. And so I decided to... turned the tables on them, and I went to the Title IX people, so I filed a complaint against the university for gender and political discrimination. And I think I have a very good case.
Isn't Title IX what the Department of Education is using to force the bathroom policies on the schools?
Title IX covers... everything in the world. I mean, where you park your car is on the title under Title IX.
But let us go back to original intent. Whether you agree with some of the
See, you had this is when in Rome, right?
but original intent of Title IX was essentially to provide separate but equal sports facilities for women, so that they would have an opportunity
to
compete.
Actually, I agree with Rush Limbaugh. Was to allow unattractive women to get more status in society. Is what really the purpose?
That's what feminism is specifically.
You can cut that part out if you want. No.
We won't cut it out.
You can say it was a joke because that's what it was.
It actually wasn't a joke. I mean,
all right.
I think there's a leveling that they're trying to get at here.
So I'm looking at your sign over there. Political correctness is just tyranny with manners.
That's exactly. Right. Exactly.
Well, I'm running on political. That's my primary plank in my campaign. So is to fight political correctness. So I'm sorry, Mike. I interrupted what you're saying.
No, that's absolutely great. Yeah.
He'll interrupt you. Don't worry about it.
And that's a great plank to have in your campaign.
Well, political correctness is the denial of reality in order to support a progressive political agenda. So it's the denial of truth is political correctness, and we're in a world now where we're acting as if there is no truth, right?
So. Well, I think there's an important point to be made there with a lot of people who are independents, you know, scary air quotes, and that is this free speech angle. Like I said at the beginning of the show, I like Mark Stein. I'm a free speech absolutist. I don't think you should be rude to people. You can choose to be rude to people, but you should pay a price for it, and they should decide what the price is, assuming it's not illegal. I don't want you shooting, beating people up and killing them and stuff, but you can shun them. I mean, whatever you want to do. If a business has a practice you don't like, don't go there. Go to the other 12 places that do the same thing. You know, this is about free speech. And so when you talk about the university system and you talk about social justice and you talk about political correctness, you're talking about free speech. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people who support the state of Oregon charging a $100,000 fine because Melissa doesn't want to make a cupcake for a gay wedding and they put her out of business don't understand that sort of framework sets up a precedent that will come and get them in the ass eventually. Sooner or later, they will shut you up over something you think is important. Mm-hmm. Or you may want to speak about something that you can't.
So here's how it's played out in Montana. So there's a guy running for governor named Greg Gianforte. Real good guy. Conservative. Social conservative. Gave money to the Family Research Council. So, but he's also a multimillionaire, hugely successful businessman. So he just donated $8 million to the university, and they're going to name a building after him, which is great. I mean, the computer sciences building, and they're going to name the program after him or something. So the LGBTQIA group is going ballistic about it. Ballistic, because he's a hater, he's awful, he hates gays, he hates transgender, he gave money to Family Research Council, which the Southern Poverty Law Center calls a hate group, right? Because if you're a Christian, you know, then obviously you're a hate group, you know, that's the way it goes. So they are up in arms that the school would actually name a building. So I actually am really proud of my university for doing that, because that was a risk.
And for actually accepting the cash and sticking to their guns.
Yeah.
More importantly, every time I read about the Southern Poverty Law Center getting involved in something, it is clear that they are not representing the poor blacks that they claim to be representing, and they are, in fact, a hate-mongering organization themselves. Sure. It is their task to shut up people that they don't agree with.
They're an anti-free speech, hate-mongering organization. Well, it's an arm of the Democratic Party.
They hate any group that hates having their speech suppressed.
Right. Right.
Basically.
And that's the goal of the left is suppression of speech. That is their primary goal. When Milo Yiannopoulos is speaking on all these campuses, they don't disagree with him. They come in with, you know, baseball bats to try to get him to stop talking. And that's, it's tyranny. So
I once asked a friend of mine who is now a full-blown, off-his-mind liberal. This was probably 10 or 15 years ago. I said, and now he's completely flipped on this. I said, would you argue that anybody who said that you shouldn't have to prove who you are to vote based on where you say you live, would you say that people who opposed that had some ulterior motive, right? And this is voter ID.
Yeah.
And he goes, well, yeah, I mean, if you like, you know, because you have to use your ID for everything, right? Why shouldn't you use your ID to vote? Everybody has them. You can't get welfare without an ID.
Right.
You can't get public services without an ID. You can't get a freaking library card without an ID.
So isn't it in fact ironic that the government that wants you to vote without showing an ID to effectively increase benefits doesn't want you to prove your ID to get those benefits?
Mm. Right.
Yeah.
In the state of New Hampshire, if you're 16 years old and you live in a house that's collecting welfare, you have to have a photo ID.
Is that right? I didn't
know
that.
To prove who you are and your eligibility.
Wow. How mean.
Right. They
haters.
The Democrats.
Haters.
They hate. So, again, it's about speech. It's about, you know, so that's the same thing. So with the speech, you're like, well, why, what if you walked up and you wanted to say your piece about an issue and a bunch of people came over and beat you to the ground with their Bibles? I mean, would you be against that? Well, yeah, they would. Right?
Of course.
Obviously.
Yeah.
So what's the difference
when
you have the Melissa Clicks of the world threatening journalists with violence because she doesn't want them to see their public display of their own opinion?
So I engaged in an online conversation with the LGBTQ kind of click, which I think is a cult. I think it's a really dangerous cult. I think they take these kids in. A lot of them are confused and questioning and going through family stuff, whatever, and they just indoctrinate them into this sort of victimization, this sort of, you know, cult, and they really turn them against society. So I think it's really, really scary. So I had an online conversation with a bunch of people, and I put some common sense out there, especially about the transgender issue in a really nice way. You know, this idea that you can self-identify without any social reality or without any kind of biological reality is completely absurd. I mean, and it's dangerous. It's just a dangerous philosophy. So I tried to challenge those assumptions they had, and there were a couple of transgender folks in the conversation. So they called my dean and tried to go after me. This was after I'd actually already left for the semester. So she told them that I was no longer at the university, which technically wasn't true because I was planning to go back in the fall. But she told them I wasn't there. So the Students for Concealed Carry people are really upset because they don't have a faculty sponsor now, because now everybody's been so intimidated about stepping up that no one wants to take it on. So they tried to hook me up with FIRE. So I've had some conversations with a couple attorneys at FIRE about maybe getting involved in this case. And they think it's a pretty promising
I would think so, especially in a state like Montana, where you would get good positive upswell from the people who live there who are all carrying.
Yeah.
Concealed or otherwise, you know, I mean.
This kid at UCLA that he was a guy that shot his professor, mm-hmm. I mean, he was carrying. You're not allowed to have a gun on the campus, but there's no metal detectors.
He shot one of them off campus anyway.
Yeah. So under concealed carry, you know, you'd be licensed to carry, right? And then the responsible people would be carrying more, right? Right now it's just the criminals that are carrying on campuses and the radicals.
Well,
and
the other thing is if you are a legal gun owner but you want to carry on campus, you have to break their law. I don't know. I mean, it's just the university's rules, really. I mean, obviously they can kick you out and keep your money if they catch you.
Right.
But I kind of look at it the same way as, like, say, going to Fridays or Buffalo Wild Wings or all these other places that say you can't carry. I carry. Mm. I just wear a coat. Mm-hmm. They don't know I'm carrying.
They don't know.
You have a permit? You're completely legal?
I have
legal?
A permit. I am perfectly legal. I got permission to wear a coat when I'm wearing my firearm, which I am wearing now. And it's an interesting argument in New Hampshire because, again, Maggie Hassan vetoed the concealed carry bill, which would basically make it optional. And lots of people would still get one because you can't get reciprocity if you don't have a pistol revolver license in the state of New Hampshire. Right. No other state can recognize what you don't have. Mm-hmm. You can carry in Maine without a permit. You can carry in Vermont without a permit. But New Hampshire is in the middle, and you have to get permission from your local police chief.
You can open carry, but you can't conceal carry.
Now, that's the thing.
Yeah.
You can open carry anywhere in the state except for a federal building, and you probably shouldn't carry on a public school because they don't like that. Mm-hmm. And that's perfectly legal. You can carry your firearm unloaded. I just crinked the end of that. Okay? Unloaded. Open and unloaded.
Yeah.
Like this, without your magazine in it, concealed.
Huh.
Okay? So I'm walking around. I have my firearm in my pocket. I have my magazine in my pocket.
Oh, jeez.
It's concealed. I remove my magazine. I take out my firearm. It's now not concealed.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
Okay? I am now loaded, and I am legally. So what's the difference? Mm. Whether I do that or whether I just pull it out of my holster, the difference is about 3 or 4 seconds. I could be dead. I could be shot. So, yes, it's not constitutional carry.
The difference is politics, right?
But it's all politics. It's all perception.
Yeah, it's an interim step, and I have to find a copy of that judgment and carry it around with me because...
State Supreme Court.
Yeah, I know. I just go look it up.
Well, the National Concealed Carry, they're winning all over the country. Pretty much every college campus where they've been involved, they've won on constitutional grounds, you know. And it just takes, you know...
Did you crimp that one or something?
No, I got to look at it. And Susan Olson posted a very important piece of information about your self-defense ammo. Now, this is defense. It's hollow point. 165 grain, okay? This one happens to have a stainless steel. I have some with brass, too. Whichever you prefer, it doesn't really matter. These are criminal stoppers because of the size of that hollow.
You realize none of my liberal friends will ever speak to me again now after you're holding a bullet up.
I just unloaded my gun in front of them.
No, they were never
pointed in a safe direction. Okay?
That's true.
And it said something about how, you know, you almost never have to fire the thing, but you carry the same magazine, the same rounds all the time, and you load and unload and whatever, and you start to crimp up the edge of this.
Oh.
Okay? And then when you actually need to shoot it, you get a jam.
Hmm.
So you need to discharge your self-defense ammo on a regular basis and refresh it so that you don't have that problem, because otherwise the entire point of carrying is mute.
Mm-hmm. So go find a target, clean the gun, put new in it.
I could go to Londonderry Fish and Game today or tomorrow and just empty it all out, go buy a fresh box. I mean, I have 1,000 rounds of regular non-hollow point ammo that I would use for target shooting.
Yeah,
this stuff's really expensive. So you don't target shoot it unless you have to empty it out and use new stuff.
I got a bunch of the Full Metal Jacket stuff.
Yeah, I'm sure there are many professors at Montana State that are concealed carrying right now. They just don't tell anybody. You know?
Well, yeah, because you can have a pretty good, pretty decent weapon, very small. Nobody knows, you know. And it's Montana.
Yeah,
I mean, they're all hiding. They're all hiding there.
I think that's why they named a building and took this guy's money, because I think they realized that the public is much different than the people in the student body or the people in the university. And I think they realized that. And what I'd like to see is a common sense scale.
You know what? I mean, the perfect answer to this thing?
What?
You say to these SJWs, you know what? I'm going to take this money of the people that you hate. I'm going to set up this faculty because it's a damn good faculty to have on the university. It's going to improve our education.
Mm.
If you don't care about your education, you only care about social justice. If you want to throw a hissy fit, leave. We have other students
exactly.
waiting to replace you
exactly.
Who are more interested in learning than making a fuss.
So several of the students threatened to leave over this situation, and so that the conservatives said, boy, this is the way we can get rid of people. So if we push concealed carry in every campus, we'll get rid of all the social justice professors on all the campuses all around the country. It's the perfect solution. Right?
Click, no more click.
Right, very good.
You can hang a Donald Trump sign and, you know, like a concealed carry, and they'll all just kind of leave.
Melissa, so. Click. Yeah. All right, we're going to take a short break. We'll be back with more of the same. Stay tuned. This is Grok Talk.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Dread at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused, and interested riveting radio show, heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at gerardatlarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
This is Grok Talk. I am Steve McDonald here with Tony and Mike and Kevin. And we're having a great conversation about Montana and gun rights and universities and fire and social justice and free speech. And we're going to keep talking about that stuff.
And how to get rid of the social justice warriors. I thought that was terrific.
It's like if we'd known it was like garlic or cross. A cross would probably work too.
So what if you paint a cross on the side of your gun and dip it in garlic? It gets rid of all evils in one go.
Holy water.
Right?
Sprinkle a little holy water on it. Right. These bullets have been bathed in holy water.
Well, we talked about justice and social justice in my class a lot this year. You know, Aristotelian justice, right, is, you know, or is if you do something, then you have a right to have something happen in response to that. So if I work hard, justice would say, well, I should probably be compensated, right? Or mm-hmm. if I do something bad, you know, I break the law or something, then justice, you know, something bad should happen to me. Right? But we've created group justice. So social justice is that entire classes of people need to be rewarded or punished. So white people need to be, you know, punished. You know, Western civilization is, you know, evil and needs to be, you know, brought down, needs to be destroyed because of all the evils that, you know, we in Western civilization have committed. So it's a collectivist mentality rather than an individual mentality. And that really is what's wrong with it.
You know? If you destroy the human race, the world will be taken over by ants.
Yeah.
Which is what some of the political philosophies, some right. masquerading as religions, actually seem to want.
Which is what they want. And the animal rights folks believe that we're, you know, I really, the reason I challenge all this sort of animal obsession stuff is because I think a lot of it is bordering on psychosis. You know, it's sort of, we need to really get rid of the human race because the human race has caused all the problems in the world. And, you know, so I think it's a collectivist mentality. You know?
I posted thing last night about some Bernie supporters who said things like, stay in the race, Bernie or bust, shun the non-believers. So I posted this picture of the followers of the Church of Euthanasia. And they have signs that say, kill your fetus, not your pet. Eat people, God. Not animals. We are the veal. It's just like,
they have a zeal for veal?
They have it. We are the veal. So like you perhaps always suggest
this
that they
is,
begin right. with yeah. themselves. Mm. Problem solved, right?
Eat
right.
yourselves first. Yes.
yes. yes.
Eat,
shoot yourselves, kill yourselves, whatever. You know, just get rid
Perfect.
Of yourselves.
That's another way to really cleanse the world of the social justice.
I mean, they probably
Take
support assisted suicide, and so, you know.
Yeah.
So lead by example.
Sure. That's a great idea.
You first.
That's a great idea.
I'll be right behind you.
Oh, boy. So it's a huge issue. I think it's dangerous. I we tend to talk about political correctness as if it's some sort of silly, you know, weird thing that people do, but it's dangerous. It's the denial of reality.
All you have to do is go on social media, social justice media, maybe. You know, search comments under newspaper articles, major media newspaper articles. Mm-hmm. Be a blogger and see who comments, and you'll get it every day. Mm-hmm. You will see some taste of it. You will see some hint of it. You will see how it motivates the way people think. Free speech.
Free speech.
You cannot – look, if you disagree with me, disagree with me. But don't make it impossible for me to disagree with you.
Yeah, I want to – I told you I started Students for Common Sense. I want to start a common sense scorecard where you can rate universities on political correctness, cultural Marxism, which is kind of common sense. And parents increasingly are looking at that kind of stuff.
Do we carry a link to Kevin's blog? And if not, why not?
There might be somewhere.
You can go to a Common Sense Community Builders. Mm-hmm. Common Sense Community Builders. I don't have a domain name reserved yet for my election campaign, but I have my Kervick 2016 principles under that webpage, Common Sense Community Builders.
I think one of the, not the last time, but the time before we had him on, after you came back from being away, we had a link, but we'll put up another
Thank
one.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah. So that's good stuff to have. But anyway, you were saying, I'm sorry, before we interrupted you.
I don't remember.
Oh,
so,
derailed your train of thought.
That it's dangerous. I think that we're not, we shouldn't act as if this is some minor thing. I think it is the destruction of Western civilization. I think that's what they're after, really. Mm. They're starting with, you know, white people, white males specifically, but really they're going after Western civilization as a whole because that they believe that the civilized world is responsible for all the problems in the world.
How dare we be civilized that we're responsible for them being uncivilized? Mm-hmm. No, perhaps you choose that. What happens if you bring down Western civilization mm-hmm. that has created more wealth and relieved more poverty than anything else in the entire history of man, in the entire millions of years of the history of man, and certainly in the last few thousand years? What's going to happen to the living style, the lifespan, and the general happiness of everybody else in the world?
Yeah,
it's all going to
the whole
sink.
Thing's over.
The whole thing's over.
And yet.
A combination of folks that basically deny the reality of human nature, mm-hmm. which I call the left wing generally, mm-hmm. and I think the left wing is appropriate. Mm-hmm. Le chemin sinistre, left hand way.
Right.
Didn't pronounce it very well. Versus and then religions which are really political. Political movements.
Oh, movements. Yeah.
Yeah. If they take over and try to defy human nature, what is going to happen to the living standards? What is going to happen to the knowledge accumulated? This is a dark ages. This is what I worry about.
Yeah, me too.
The new dark ages is not far away. It is up to us to prevent it from starting.
Yes, absolutely. And that's what I'm trying to do. I don't know. I wanted to mention in the last segment that the IQ in the Western world has declined in the last 10 years. First time it's ever declined since they've actually measured it.
But wait.
We're getting dumber as a people.
But the measuring
system... That doesn't surprise me
The
at
measuring
all.
System's unfair. It's too white. It's
that's
too
true.
Western.
That's true.
No, seriously?
Seriously, it has declined.
Seriously, what is happening is that what is being taught is so bad,
rubbish,
that the methods of measurement mm-hmm. are basically showing the fact that the kids are being taught to be dumb, mm-hmm. not to think well.
Well, we have social promotion, right? You just move kids kind of along, But we're also making intelligence uncool. Right? It's not cool to be smart anymore. You have to be some other thing.
Yo, bro, you're acting white, bro.
Yeah. My kids were the first grade to be exposed to sight reading. You ever hear of this?
Yeah, sight reading's been around since Dewey.
Yeah, so that's another socialist way.
Dewey dumbed them down.
So they weren't taught phonics, because phonics is from the privileged class, I guess, and you have to have a certain kind of brain to be able to do that. And so they teach visual learners to see a whole word not to sound it out, but to just remember mm-hmm. whole words. So it's actually reinforcing, bad intelligence skills.
That is actually brain strain to do that, to memorize stuff, to memorize individual nuggets of information, whether it be words or facts or scientific or mathematical formulae. Mm-hmm. In isolation, remember this formula to do that. Mm-hmm. It's brain strain. It doesn't work.
Right. Well, that's the whole point. It handicaps your ability to learn because you can't look at a word you've never seen before and understand how to say it.
Logical incrementalism. Right.
Right. Right. All knowledge in mathematics, in science, even in history, is built upon prior knowledge. All knowledge in literacy and literature is mm-hmm. built upon understanding the language, the sentence construction, the phrase construction, mm-hmm. the passing of the verbs. If you don't know these things,
right.
you can't figure out what an unusual construction actually means. Mm-hmm. And it results in dumber people, in less literate people. Mm-hmm. And to give a fairly simple example, I don't think I was the smartest guy in my class. Indeed, in my high school class, probably not. But I joined the Royal Air Force, and I was in a class of folks studying engineering, and, of course, along with that, math and English and history. Mm-hmm. And there were folks who stayed up sweating, literally, every night for exams to memorize the piece-by-piece stuff that they would need to fill in the blanks in the exam in the morning. And I didn't do any of that stuff. Because I challenged and questioned as I went along. I built my knowledge incrementally. I had a base. I could construct the next level from what I knew. Mm-hmm. And I did better on the exams than they did. Mm. And the point is that, it's not that I'm so much smarter than those other people, but it's a difference in methods. Yeah. And I think the difference in methods is important, and I think they're teaching the wrong method. And I think what you're pointing out is exactly that.
If you are interested in a history and a detailed understanding of sight reading, Robin Eubank's book Credentialed to Destroy excellent covers it outstandingly.
I think I read some of that. Yeah.
You should.
She digs through it all. I mean, the whole book is fabulous.
Yeah.
I haven't finished it yet, but so far all of it. But Robin Eubank's Credentialed
We have a copy at home,
Tony.
Yeah, well, I'll just make a note of it so I remember it.
And it's time we had her on again.
We haven't had her on for a while.
She's done a lot more research. We should get her in with Ellen Kolb or...
Oh, yeah. Robin's a great Anne-Marie guest. Banfield. We could just call her up and say, hey, you want to be on the show? She'd be, yeah, let's go. She's awesome. She'll just be in her kitchen doing something, and she'll just talk to us while she's doing whatever she's doing.
She's got a teenage daughter in the schools in Atlanta. Okay. She was a corporate lawyer. She was very analytical as part of her job.
She did research.
She did research law, basically, or even technical research to back up her lawyerism. Mm. And she got into studying the history of all of the things, Agenda 21, whatever, that is behind the dumbing down of education and the indoctrination.
Well, they want a C-minus world, and they want everybody to be basically slightly
well they want them
average,
like Robin says they want generations of people who are sheep whom they can push around with their superior expert
you
intellect.
Can't have exceptionalities in socialism. You have to
everybody's got to be meh.
Exactly. You've got to defy human nature.
Anyway, you can get that book on Kindle or Nook. Mm-hmm. It's very readily available.
Credentialed to Destroy by Robin Eubanks, Eubanks. Not related to the guy that played late at night in the band with Jay Leno. This is a lady in Atlanta, and she's red hot on this stuff.
And not the game show host guy, Bob Eubanks.
Mm-hmm. No.
Maybe. I don't know. I actually don't know if they're related.
And to all the people that are trying to create this C-minus world, I say, bah, humbug.
meh, humbug.
I tell my classes I'm going to give them all C-minuses in the beginning. But half the kids say, that sounds good to me. And then there's always one or two that are like, no, I want to get an A. And I said, well, that's not fair. I mean, these poor kids over here aren't as smart as you, and you, it's not right for you to be able to excel ahead of them. And then they finally get it after a while, but usually it's when we're talking about socialism and capitalism. But
which is so rare on a college campus, unless you're talking about promoting it as a way of life.
Right. But we've done it in college, so the wrong kids are going to college. Right? We have too many kids in this college. It shouldn't be there. teachers are feeling enormous pressure to have to, you know, inflate grades to, you know, keep for retention, to keep all these marginal kids in school that shouldn't even be in school to begin with.
And in self-defense, then, the employers have to test the potential employees to make sure that the ones that went to college actually learned anything.
Yeah, right. And half of them haven't. So the big lawsuit happened last week. I don't know if you covered it, Steve, but several Asian groups, and I hate this word Asian. What does that mean? There's so many different groups. We call them all Asian, Koreans, and I don't even know what Asian means, but these so-called Asian...
We're all right with
right? Anybody from Pakistan to Japan.
Okay, all Asian. They're suing Harvard and several other schools.
Oh, I've heard of this. I haven't covered it, I don't think.
Because they're not getting enrolled. They're not getting in. So there's so many qualified students at the upper end that schools are selecting out by ethnicity and race because they... You know, they want to have a diverse campus.
So let's have people in of whatever color, let's say green, because I'm not trying to offend anybody here, that aren't quite as smart as the folks that are of a faintly yellow tint. Faintly not green color. They want the green people to be adequately represented, so exactly. They're going to bring them in even if they're dumb.
So the Asians are really angry about that because their kids aren't getting in. They're suing all these schools.
Good.
Which is an interesting development.
It's high time.
They have plenty of money.
It should be purely...
Harvard's endowment is what? $2 billion, $3 billion?
No, try 50.
$50 billion.
Crazy thing.
I know it was a big number.
It's an astronomical number. Mm-hmm. It's a Warren Buffett kind of number.
It's a redistribute the wealth kind of number?
Yeah. They could afford to give free tuition to just about every kid that went through the place and still make money.
Yeah. I think colleges, we're at the beginning of this. We're going to see a major explosion, implosion very soon.
Yeah, well, I think so. It's economically untenable. More and more kids, more and more parents that I talk to are choosing community colleges mm-hmm. as the first step or even as the only step. Yes. They are paying a whole bunch less and working harder to make up the difference. Mm-hmm. My grandson is in a community college. He drives to their library on nights when he's not working and it's not for classes, but to sit in their library and study under good conditions.
Sure. I mean, it's a big jobs program, just like you're talking about the heroin clinics and the mm-hmm. whole, you know, kind of medical establishment. It's a major jobs program, you know, so there's no incentive to have only the cream of the crop go to college. The more they can go, the better, right?
Yeah. You
know, both of my kids are in community college, but I told them, I said, there's nothing wrong with going to a trade school. You'll Absolutely. Make more money coming out of the gate, you know, than you would. You know, if you want to, I went to college for a year and a half. I didn't get a degree. I started at McDonald's at $2.35 an hour back in the 70s. And I worked my way into management, and I got corporate management training from them, which I took to another chain, which I eventually took out of food service into high tech. Mm. And then I picked up, and the skills I had learned allowed me to have an awareness of quality assurance, which led me into quality assurance. Mm. Mm-hmm. I ended up in shipping and receiving, some distribution, some materials handling. I now do technical writing. I do engineering support. I do some marketing. Mm. I help the salespeople out. I do shipping and receiving. I do this like 70 different things. Mm. And I don't have a degree. Yeah. I didn't graduate from college.
You could have
I learned all these skills because I worked my ass off doing it. Sometimes I worked two or three jobs.
I don't have a formal degree either. I worked my way up. I went through the Air Force. I did additional qualifications at night, but it didn't actually quite add up to a degree. Over time, I accrued enough knowledge that when I came to this country and I was assessed, as you have to be to get your green card, they said, yeah, it's equivalent to a Bachelor of Science, but I never actually have a stamped piece of paper that says that.
Now, I don't make a lot of money, but I manage my money in a way that I have two cars, I have three kids, I have a nice four-bedroom colonial on 2.5 acres of land in a nice town, in a nice neighborhood, in a nice state, and I live pretty comfortably. I mean, I don't go on vacations because I can't afford them. We don't go out to eat a lot because it's expensive. Mm. You know, yes, the price pressures make us make different choices, but we're not uncomfortable.
You're obviously a hater.
I am a hater.
You're a hater.
Yes, it's my white privilege. It's because I'm white.
You're not appreciating your skin color. You're obviously a hater.
But, yeah. Yes, and I was a hater when I was getting up at midnight working at UPS and then going to my day job so that my wife could raise our children.
You could have been
an
African-American lesbian with a disability. You could have just jumped right up to that.
I could have, yeah.
Or you can identify as that.
Or I could just join the Democrat Party and get a high-paying job as a political analyst of some sort or a consultant. Actually, axe grinder. I could recruit people to go and protest Trump rallies.
Yeah. Oh, there you go. That'll work.
I would know how to use Craigslist, which I don't.
So speaking of the opioid crisis, were we talking about that?
Yeah, why don't we take
why don't we do that? And why don't we bring Tony into this, because he's actually worked in the field of drug rehabilitation.
Right. Why don't we take a break, and then we'll do that for the last segment. Everybody hang in. We'll be right back.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Gerard at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused and interested, riveting radio show, heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at GerardAtLarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now at the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
Rock Talk brought to you by GraniteRock.com.
.com.
And the Coalition of New Hampshire Taxpayers. CNHT Picnic's coming up. Go to CNHT.org. You can visit GraniteRock.com to find a link to a place to get tickets if you don't want to go to CNHT.org.
I see the map on the front page.
Yes, and if you click the map, it goes to Google Maps and you can open it up and see where you need to go to get there. So it's in Manchester this year, so it's not in the middle of nowhere in southern New Hampshire. It's in the middle of somewhere in southern New Hampshire.
I'm going to miss the drive up the dirt turnpike.
The New Hampshire Turnpike?
Yeah.
That long, straight dirt road.
Second New Hampshire Turnpike.
Right. It's a great drive. It's a lovely drive, especially if it's nice out.
Engaged four-wheel drive, take down the roof, and alley-hoof.
And it's all flat, too. It's like you're driving through Kansas. There's almost no
with trees at the end.
With trees on either side, because there's no trees in Kansas.
No. Just corn.
Yes, just corn, which is taller than trees would be. It's just freaking corn and stuff. Pigs.
Johnny Carson made a joke. You know what the Kansas motto is? Mm. Gateway to Nebraska.
All right. So apparently we have an opioid crisis in New Hampshire. And we're going to talk about that again because, hey, we have somebody who had some across-the-pond experience with regard to this sort of thing. Mm.
And Kevin, who's good at analyzing the people again.
And I've done drug treatment as well, a lot of historically. So
I'm going to read this little quote because it's right here in front of me. Well, it was right in front of me. Now it's not, so I guess I'm not going to read it because I can't find it. There we go.
Theodore Dalrymple?
Yes, from Romancing Bureaucracies.
Yeah, medical iatrogenesis was the term I used before, but I think
every
right
problem in contemporary society calls forth its equal and supposedly opposite bureaucracy. Mm-hmm. The ostensible purpose of this bureaucracy is to solve that problem, but the bureaucracy quickly develops a survival instinct and so no more wishes the problem to disappear than the lion wishes to kill all the gazelle in the bush and leave itself with no food for the future. In short, the bureaucracy of drug addiction needs drug addicts far more than drug addicts need the bureaucracy.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah.
It's a great book, Romancing Opiates. I highly recommend it at every opportunity. It is available on Kindle.
I can tell a little story about that. I worked in, I managed a sheltered workshop for a while, with people with developmental disabilities. We used to say mental retardation at the time. I don't know what we call it now, actually. I think it's, I don't know. But, you know, we were paying people.
Transgenderism?
I don't know.
Oh, I'm going to get mail for that.
We were paying people.
people with a condition that the government will pay money for.
And we actually made a little money off of we actually had, it was a real place. We actually made money. So we were making money off people with disabilities. And, you know, sometimes they would get better. You know, like they would be ready for like a real job. And we'd be like, oh, we hate to lose this person. You know, we don't really, because they're making, they're our best worker. You know, but our job as a social service agency was to get them real jobs. So I had a great boss. He was a weird guy, but a great boss. And he said to me one time, said, Kevin, every Friday I want you to spend 3 hours thinking about how to put yourself out of business. So what he was saying is that we exist for the clients, but to get them healthy. You know, it's not our the bureaucracy isn't what matters. You know, it's the clients.
That's the role of every quality manager in every company in the world, to make themselves useless.
But do we do that in human services? No, we don't. We need the addicts. We need mentally ill people. We need depression. We need anxiety so we can give them medication. You know, we need a system that we need clients, you know. And a guy by the name of John McKnight, I don't know if you read John McKnight's work, but he wrote a book called The Careless Society. And he said what we're doing is we're clientizing society. We're creating clients. So addicts, people with health issues, disabilities, whatever. We need clients to make keep our professional services system
going. Well, 30% of most public school budgets are special services now.
Yeah. So the special education, great example. It's a complete disaster, right? I mean, we're labeling kids, putting them in all these kinds of programs, many of which don't work at all, but they just keep perpetuating, keep going on.
Because there's money.
Meanwhile, the kid in the, you know, this sort of middle, the quiet kid that sits in the back of the class, it's not in special ed, you know, is getting no attention, no services, no, you know, no enrichment at all, because all the money goes to the gifted kids or to the kids in the special education. So if I'm elected state senator, I will address that to the best of my ability.
Well, I believe that the states should disavow any of the federal money for special ed.
Absolutely.
On the grounds that, if I recall this from Ovid's gubernatorial campaign, the figures are something like the feds are supposed to pay 40% of the cost of that which they mandate, and they pay 17%.
Right. It was originally supposed to be more than 40, wasn't it?
Well, probably. But the thing is,
same
that,
with Medicaid.
These programs exist, but the government that mandates them isn't paying for them. The states have increased their cost of education by more than the amount that the federal government pays them because of the bureaucracy, the managers, the special education specialists. If you eliminated a lot of those people and just brought in the right kind of teaching aides to bring along the ones that had a little bit of trouble, it would cost you less, your tooth-to-tail ratio would be better, and you wouldn't need the federal money at all.
Well, back in the day, anybody like that, kids in wheelchairs who were mentally disabled or anything that were still even in a public school at all, had their own little room, and they had a teacher who helped them move along at the best of their ability. Now you have kids who are deaf, dumb, and blind who are expected to have class-level work tailored for them by a special person called a paraeducator, who has a boss whose job is to tailor the work so that the educator can then direct the student with the work, even if the kid can't do the work.
With very questionable ideology, mixed benefit. We have no idea if mainstreaming works. Well, a lot of research suggests it doesn't work.
It doesn't. I mean, my wife has done this for years, and now she's a parent in a kindergarten room. She's basically a teaching aide. Or a co-teacher of sorts, making much less money, managing kids in the kindergarten, and there are, of course, other kids who are disabled, and then they have their own pair, and they bring them in. It's just a lot of extra people and a lot of overhead, and again, it is questionable. I mean, I don't necessarily want to say, well, these women aren't doing good work.
Oh, they're working hard.
I mean, they're busting their asses. They care about these kids. They want them to succeed, but they're working in a system that isn't designed for that to happen.
No, and the paperwork is astronomical. It's all legalese and cover your butt so you don't get sued. And I have a friend who's a psychologist, and he spends more time in court than he does with kids. Just constant bureaucracy, constant lawsuits. So that's, you know, political correctness is my thing, but the other issue I think I could bring to the table if I was elected is reform, human services and education. And it's what we're talking about, paring down the bureaucracy, the paperwork, the documentation, the superfluous staff, the all that stuff.
And the staff are basically defensive. They're there to protect the school or whatever organization it is against either lawsuits or government action. Mm-hmm. So let's sort of turn to the drug crisis for a minute, and let's hear your views on it and hear a little bit from the ground here in the UK.
Well, I'm very interested in what you were saying, because when I first came to Nashua, I read the newspapers. Even when I go back to the UK, I listen to Frank FM occasionally. And you'd hear of terrible murders committed by a small group of people. Mm. Horrible things happened occasionally, very occasional, here in Concord and in New Hampshire. But it's only on this visit now that I start seeing this being a big issue and the numbers rising. Mm-hmm. And it reminds me somewhat of Amsterdam. Mm. In Holland back in the 70s. I worked as a volunteer. I was working in a coffee company at the time, tea and coffee company. But I worked as a volunteer in the evenings with a drug agency. And there were several deaths a week, every week in Amsterdam, mostly visitors from opiate overdose. Now, last year, I went over to Amsterdam, and I happened to spend an evening with some ambulance men. Mm. And one of them mentioned to me that they don't pick up opiate overdoses anymore. There are very, very few of them. So I wanted to know, how is this?
What happened?
He said that this was December, it was Christmas, and in the whole previous year he'd picked up one opiate overdose, which for an ambulance in Amsterdam was remarkable. I asked him what it was, what was the treatment that was working, clearly something was. No, what had happened was that a group, I think it was the Moluccans, he said, a particular group from a racial group, had taken over the bulk of the dealing of the heroin. Mm. And when they supply the heroin, they would not allow people to inject. Mm. If they wanted to test the quality, they had to smoke.
Mm. There you go.
So it's nothing to do with the treatment whatsoever.
I believe that. I believe that. And I believe, and I also believe it's a spiritual crisis. I mean, I don't think they should have ever put, in the States we have something called the DSM-5, DSM whatever, and they put alcohol and drug addiction in as a disorder in the 1970s. I don't think they should have ever done that. I'm not saying people don't get a physical addiction, but it's a crisis of spirituality, habit.
It's giving it a label.
Family issues, whatever. And, we're living in a malaise now. The Obama years have been this awful, the dark ages, where everybody's in a malaise. The economy's stagnant. Nobody believes in anything.
94 million people stopped looking for work.
Yeah, there's no upward mobility. There's no sense of a bright future. Yeah, people think we're
wage
going the wrong
pressures
direction.
Are keeping starting jobs from being created. Things
right,
like
so
that.
Is there any surprise that people are turning to opiates or anything to give themselves, high, make them feel
for a bit of perspective in romancing opiates, there's a lot of examples of people who used heroin like on the weekends for 50 years and never became addicted. People who, examples of people who had to use regularly for 8 to 10 months before they really got themselves to a state where they were uncomfortable without it. Lots of examples of where people who were forced to quit did without issues.
One of the best examples of that is the vets from Vietnam.
Mm. Yep, that's an excellent
hell
example.
Hell of a lot of use of opioids.
Tons of
in
it.
Vietnam.
They just came home and stopped using it.
Absolutely.
Chairman Mao said that if you use heroin in China when he took over, and this isn't a great example because he's a murderer, he said, we're going to kill all the drug dealers if we catch them, and we're going to kill you if we catch you using. Mm. And there was like 1.3 million, at least one. Maybe 3 million users of heroin when he took over. They all quit. Nobody died from that. See, that's the thing. Everybody, the culture of addiction is the major issue that is addressed by Dr. Dalrymple. The media, Hollywood, television, the bureaucracy, they've created this fantasy about addiction and heroin in particular.
Interesting.
And how it's this horrible, awful thing, and it's not. You can detox from heroin in 2 to 3 days with flu-like symptoms, with maybe over-the-counter painkillers if you're that uncomfortable, and then it's all psychological. You just have to choose to stop. Once you decide in your head that you don't want to do it, you just stop doing it. You take a couple days off. You're done.
Yeah, I believe that, and I've seen that.
And that is, I mean, he was in prison doctor, yeah. hundreds of examples, thousands of examples of people who were put in prison and couldn't take drugs anymore, and they just didn't.
Yeah,
so let me just quote a literary example. If you read books from the times of Sherlock Holmes, you know, that were written by Conan Doyle and by his contemporaries, opium dens were a commonplace thing in London, just as much as gin parlors and pubs. Mm-hmm. And people used them, and they went back to their regular lives. There were some wretched creatures that got stuck into that. But the vast majority of people used them and went home.
And
again,
there weren't as many deaths. No. I mean, there were overdoses, and there were, but I mean, not as many.
But you know what? It's hard to maybe compare the opium den with the evil corporation. But the left and big government ties will tell you that both want to kill their customers. Mm. And the answer is, no, they don't. The opium den operator wants his customers to keep coming back, not to OD and die.
They don't want to kill their customers any more than the bureaucracy wants to cure them.
No. And that is exactly the point. And the evil corporations...
Sorry. I already started laughing.
And the evil corporations... The big government types will tell you are selling you stuff that's bad for you. No, they want you to keep buying. They're not going to sell stuff that's bad for you. They're not going to kill their customers, sell you dangerous tools or poisonous food. And so this the same thing here. And so, in fact, the big government types have it exactly backwards, which is that the purveyors of this stuff want repeat customers, whereas the government types that purport to want to cure the problem also want repeat customers and are therefore going to perpetuate the problem rather than solve it.
Exactly. And we've got a pharmaceutical industry that just feeds on it. You know, they need customers. So depression and anxiety have skyrocketed in the last 30 years or so, and so has Prozac. So,
well, you know, with all those social justice warriors out there telling you what a victim you are, you know.
Right. It's also, Kevin, it's my personal belief, and I value your opinion on this, but when people die from opiate overdoses, that is a real problem. Mm-hmm. It's very, very sad to see a young person or an old person die from that. Yeah. It's the pain that's left behind in the families and the suffering within the community. I don't believe that it's actually... occasionally somebody get a very strong batch of heroin, they say, and that will cause people to go over. But more often than not, I believe, it's because people become so entrenched in the way of life, it becomes so difficult to obtain, they get in so much trouble, they get isolated from their families, and they become so depressed, they simply don't care. It's not that they deliberately overdose, but they don't care if they die. And that's because of what's happening in their lives. It's not the actual drug itself. It's the way that we as a society are dealing with it. And I don't have the answer for that. I hope you do.
No, I agree strongly with that. And Finland is actually trying to address it that way. When someone has a psychiatric break or a serious drug-induced situation, they heap psychosocial supports around them. So they work with the families, they work with the community, the neighborhoods, to really just rally around them to get them out of the bad community and into a healthy kind of community, and they have remarkable results. And they also don't fill them up with psychotropic medication. They don't addict them to the good drugs, and so they never have to get off the good drugs. Whereas in the U.S., if you have a psychiatric issue, we make you a victim immediately. You're disabled. We give you a diagnosis. We put you on Medicaid. You are basically stuck in your addiction or your psychiatric disability for the rest of your life because we want you there.
Because the system wants customers.
We need you there. We need you there. Exactly right. So the addiction treatment system is based on making people sick and keeping them sick, and that's why we're seeing such bad health outcomes, in my opinion.
I compare that with Alcoholics Anonymous, which basically wants you to believe in something bigger than yourself and to get the heck out of the program as soon as you don't need it.
Yeah, so AA is a
spiritual program.
With
that, actually. They want to keep you in. An alcoholic, always an alcoholic. Yeah, Alcoholics Anonymous
there's a cultishness of that as well.
Real issue there, Mike.
You have to continue to go to meetings.
But I don't mean to do Alcoholics Anonymous down, because I think they save thousands, millions of lives. I really, really support them. But I think there is an issue there of creating that dependency, which is exactly what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Well, the interesting thing about it, though, is that the meetings don't cost money. I mean, they're generally pretty much generic grassroots, at least in America. Yeah. I mean, because I grew up in this culture, because both of my parents were recovering alcoholics, and they rehabilitated alcoholics till their death in their 80s. Mm-hmm. Most of the people I grew up knowing who were grown-ups were addicts. They were addicted to alcohol. I met lots of people. Mm-hmm. I went to more wakes by the time I was 12 than most people go to in their lives.
Wow.
Because my parents knew these people. Mm-hmm. And so that's just how it is. I mean, they're not charging you. But they encourage you to make sure that you have a mentor, that you have a sponsor, that you're talking to somebody, because life is difficult and things happen. And it's really easy to go back to drinking. And detoxing from alcoholism can kill you, mm-hmm. whereas detoxing from heroin will not. Yeah. So we have about 60 seconds left.
It's another reason I'm not for pot legalization. I'm okay with criminalization and decriminalization, but it's because of that culture. You get these people caught up in this kind of pot culture, and it sort of takes over their whole life, you know. And they get separated from other friends that aren't the high friends. So, I think that's the problem.
Well, we've solved a lot of the world's problems here today. the program in which we solve the problem of how to get the social justice warriors off of campus, how to get the guns onto campus, how to deal with the addiction problems of the world. But, Kevin, you're running for Senate from Nashua. So, once again, how can people look you up?
Okay, for now, I don't have a registered domain name yet. So, go to Common Sense Community Builders. Common Sense Community Builders, one long word, and you'll find the Common Sense site. And you'll see Kervick 2016 on the left-hand column. Just click on that. I spent a lot of time identifying my ideas, so hopefully you'll like them.
All right, we're out of here. Everybody have a great weekend, and we'll talk to you next week.
The opinions expressed on this program are those of the speakers and not necessarily those of CNHT, GraniteRock.com, this station, or anyone else for that matter. Some of the content on this program is shared under the fair use provision of U.S. copyright law, found free in the public domain, or covered under Attribution 3.0. Some of the music on this program is provided by Kevin MacLeod at Incompetech.com.